to discuss today. There are a couple of key areas that I don't think we've talked about in any depth, and I'm hoping that this panel, this very esteemed group of people, will be able to focus us in on. And those are two key areas. One is leadership. What are the leadership capabilities that are going to take us into these new models of care and deliver a sustainable future, and the characteristics of that leadership? And the second area that I think is hugely important is integration of social care and healthcare. We've talked very clearly around the health delivery aspects, but we all know, and particularly if you're at all aware of what's going on in the UK environment at the moment, the absolute crisis that has hit both social care and the healthcare sector means that the two are coming together, and we need to consider them in the round if we are going to deliver a sustainable future. Having said that, I've set my speakers today a task of trying to be upbeat. It's always hard when you have a UK audience and a UK panel to be upbeat, but we are going to be glass half full at the end here to try and end on a sense of positivity and energy around the fact that we can instill some change, even if it's not change overnight. So with that, I'd like to introduce the panellists that we have. We have Katie Wood, who is the Director of Operations at Arup. And whilst you might know them more around some of the buildings environment that we talked about early, Katie's actually responsible for the integration of people, process, and the assets that deliver better health outcomes. Great experience here in the UK, which she'll talk about, but also immense experience from Canada and Australia. So it might be useful to seek some insights around that. And an engineer by background, and I think that's hugely important because I think that gives us a different insight into process and methodology to deliver change. We have Ian Smith, who many of you, I'm sure, know, is the special advisor to Four Seasons Healthcare, again, bringing that social care into view, was also the CEO of General Healthcare, which had 70 facilities under his management. But most interestingly, because I asked him earlier, he was part of the Middle East peace process alongside Tony Blair. And we think we've got difficulties here in trying to build collaboration and partnership. If there's anything that has been an entrenched problem for many years, I think, again, leadership and cultural sensitivities. Ian can bring some insights around that. And finally, Mike, which you prefer? Okay. I'll call you the Director of Strategy.
I'm Canadian too, so I can be upbeat with that.
Okay. Pleased to hear that. Well, Michael McDonnell, who is the leader for strategy at NHS England, and is really someone who can give us great insight into a whole new way of thinking, which is devolved responsibility, regional capabilities, population health, delivering care that is suited to a population and a region rather than a one-size-fits-all model, but also has international experience, having conducted some research and projects with Lord Darcy, who I know is very much aligned to this institution. So with that, hopefully you realise we've got some good people here today. I'd like to go to you, Katie, in the first instance, for you to tell us a bit about some projects where you think we're actually making progress, and if you can bring some insights to those projects that focus in on this aspect of cultural leadership. Who are the people? Where is the talent that is going to take us into delivering sustainable models of care?
Okay, well, I'd like to talk about systems leadership and some work. We've actually been working for 10 years with the NHS East Midlands Leadership Academy, which is, despite the heritage in the built environment, is absolutely nothing to do with the built environment. It's about the development of leadership capability within the NHS. And we work with them through the delivery of various different sorts of leadership development training and facilitation. We developed a systems leadership model. So in other words, We talk a lot about systems leadership and the fact that it's needed more and more in the world, in the world that the NHS and others in healthcare are now experiencing, in order to work across the various organisational boundaries that we have. But what do we actually mean by this? What does it look like? What are the behaviours? What are the skills and capabilities needed in order to be an effective systems leader? And that model enables the development of those leaders to actually, be meaningful and achieve things. And as I say, it's been running for quite some time, and you know, we are able to kind of, there's a wide range of alumni from the academy across the East Midlands, and we're able to bring in some success stories of how they have used those skills to on real world problems, whether they're incremental change or disruptive innovation, and effect real change. You know, examples such as you know, to the social care example, either avoiding the admission or speeding up the discharge of elderly patients, and just adding up the number of bed days that saves, and that you know, you can put a cost on that quite easily, and that is through, you know, someone at a sort of mid-management level taking it into their own hands to link up different bits of the system in a way that hasn't been done before. I mean, none of this is rocket science, but it just isn't commonly done because people aren't empowered. And so this model's then taken up by the National NHS Leadership Academy, and there is some guidance out there. So I suppose I would, you know, rather than we started the day talking about, you know, at a real national health system level, I'm now going down to a real pointy end, people who really are at the pointy end of this, and how we empower them to make a difference.
Okay, I'm going to make five points briefly, and I'll go quickly through this. So, you know, let's come back to it if you want to discuss it. And really what I'm interested in is system change and why we haven't had system change in the UK, and what I think we should do about it. And I'll use one or two examples from the social care sector to illustrate it. So I think there's little doubt about where we want to get to over 5 or 10 years. We want integrated care organisations out of hospital that wrap care around patients and manage patients over full cycles of care. And in hospital, we need academic health science centres, the first of which was here at Imperial, which my brother set up with his colleagues here. My brother was here this morning, but being a medic, he's got a very short attention span, so he isn't here this afternoon. And within those AHSCs, within the academic health science centres, especially with the rise of genetic medicine, a real focus on and making choices about areas of research to focus on, linking that to clinical practice and consolidating clinical units, because with the advance of biomedical science over the last 30 years, it's clear that scale is important and that it saves life. Secondly, that brings us to a puzzle. You know, why is it if we have outcome data that consolidating clinical units improves outcomes? And we've got a very good example at the hyperacute stroke unit in London, coming down from about 40 units to about 8, with 20 to 30% improvement in outcomes. Why is that still one of the few examples that we talk about through the country? What is it that prevents system change more widely? We hear about bed blocking. You'll be shocked to hear that throughout the care home sector, we have 5,000 beds empty right this moment, right this very moment. So we know that there are frail elderly people, most of them living with dementia, suffering, dying more quickly as a result of being in acute wards inappropriately, yet we cannot get those frail elderly people living with dementia out to the care home sector, which will probably look after them as well or better than in hospital. And on top of the 5,000 empty beds, we're rapidly closing hospitals because the economics, the money is not there out of hospital. So we'll probably see 50,000 beds come out of the care home sector in the next 4 years. And there's only 100,000 beds in the NHS. So that's number two. So why don't things change? Why, despite really committed clinicians and carers? Why? Because, you know, in spite of us having some of the probably the best biomedical science per capita in the world. Obviously, the Americans are ahead of us, but you know, the Britain performs incredibly well, and an accessible service that's free at the point of care. Why are we stuck in 1948 with largely district general hospitals, a GP, distributed GP network, and really no out-of-hospital social care setting? And my belief is that it is a supply-side monopoly, and that you know, good-hearted people, and I think Simon Stevens is a very good-hearted, smart bloke. I think Jeremy Hunt is a good bloke. But I think they try to form change. They try to bring about change by using supply-side mechanisms. And it's what you would do if you were in the system. You can reorganize. You know, you can launch initiatives, new care models. you can increase regulation. And they are done regularly, year after year. And the sad fact is that they don't actually end up changing the system. There might be a short-term improvement, but they don't actually end up shifting the system from 1948 with an epidemiology of disease that was completely different in 1948 compared to the epidemiology of disease and social need in 2017. So thirdly, what I think you need are demand-side mechanisms. I'll just mention them and so you can come back to them. Firstly, we need high-quality public information on outcomes. Which units are producing the best outcomes in both health and social care? Secondly, we need real choice. We need to give this system back to the citizens of the country. They will discipline the system. If they are going to live longer and better by going to one provider compared to another, then they will do it and they will discipline the system. And they are much more aware, much more omnipresent than regulators who try to do a good job but are hugely stretched, of course. Thirdly, for that to happen, you do need competition. It's the dirty word in the NHS. It should not be. The only criteria should be which provider, public, private, third sector, men from Mars, which provider produces the best patient outcomes over a full cycle of care at the lowest cost to the payer, which in our case is mostly the taxpayer. Fourthly, personal budgets. Until the money follows the patient, it will flow back into the hospitals and back into the GP practices, with a very small amount of money going into community care, which is where it flowed in 1948. And finally, of course, you do need expert commissioning. This cannot be a free-for-all. You do need scale commissioning, not 211 CCGs, STPs. Let's hope they do produce proper scale expert commissioning that can manage a market and manage over time to the destination we know we want to get to, which is ICOs, integrated care organizations, out of hospital, academic health science. And finally, where I would start, we always start with sort of top-down, let's reorganize the service, let's have new care models. We should start, I believe, with vulnerable people right now. We should start with the 20 hospitals that have the worst delayed discharge, and don't just go in and solve delayed discharge. Take the 100 frequent flyers in each of those hospitals, or 50, it's a very small number. Put a package of care around each of those individuals and manage them through to end of life in the case of frail elderly. Rushing through, whether the local authority objects or the GPs don't agree with it or the clinical commissioning group doesn't agree with it. Real leadership that takes responsibility for people's outcomes, cohorts of individuals, rather than managing units, institutions, hospitals, care homes or whatever. A similar example with Tier 4 CAMHS, which is the acute end of children, adolescent health. There are only 1,200 in that category throughout the country, yet we have failed to put care packages around them, manage them over full cycles of care. Over time, we will get to the integrated care organization in 5-10 years' time. The five-year forward view is absolutely right. That's where we need to get to. But we can't start with it now. We need to start by focusing on real vulnerable need right now, introducing the demand side mechanisms I've talked about, and to end on a note of optimism, if we do that, we will transform our system. Yeah.
So Mike, very interesting, and we'd love to hear why, with this development of the STB, the five-year forward review, which has come from the centre, tell us why it will be different this year, this time, and we're 2 years in, what are the successes to date?
So I'm going to come back to that, if you don't mind. I enjoyed listening to the Smith plan. I thought that was really, that was fantastic. I took some notes, and as it turns out, we're going to put out our own plan tomorrow, so we'll see how many of them line up. I just want to start a little bit with locating the debate in the innovation puzzle, as Ian put it, and narrow in a little bit of what we're going to say about innovation in that plan in particular, and we can zoom back out and talk about STPs or whatever other people want to talk about. I think the first thing I think to remember is that the NHS actually should play a greater role in supporting basic science. And this is not all, people think the NIHR is the only place that can do this. I don't think so. I think we've got to do more on that. And indeed, we are going to do some more on that. So just to take a couple of specifics, by the end of 2018, we will have sequenced 100,000 genomes in this country. It's a major advance compared to other countries. We have taken more samples. It helps support the biomedical industry that Ian referred to. We've got to take, I think, greater steps to make clinical trials much easier to do in this country and to make sure we continue to fire the industrial engine, which is the sort of pharma and biomedical industry in this country. We could do lots more on that. Harmonizing approval and recruitment processes, for instance, is something that we'll target and talk about more in the coming weeks. Secondly, I think we can do a lot more to foster real-world data, real-world testing on the way to getting to rollout. So we do too much, we think about the lab too much and too little about what the NHS, how the NHS should be testing technologies or new ways of delivering care in its actual practice. And this is partly, as sort of Ian hinted at, because it's quite hard to change lots of our NHS. And Junaid, who's up there in the back, has been helping us with one of our programs where we try to pair technologies with what we're calling test beds, bits of the NHS that want to move faster, that want to try to implement technologies alongside service change. There's some really interesting stuff going on in Surrey, for instance, where we're using wearables to help people get out of hospitals who've got dementia, stay at home, not even go to care homes if we can get away with it. But there's plenty more we can be doing to foster that sort of across-system experimentation and to get the sort of data that we would need to see it roll out a little bit more further. Also, academic health science networks and centers, I think, incredibly important part of our architecture. If we're being honest, still a little bit underdeveloped, and we've got a long way to go on them, but we've got to double down, I think, on that investment and see them as a way of testing, rolling out, helping industry and science connect with the NHS. And again, we'll be saying more about that in the coming weeks. And then to come to your sort of the what this panel's about is there is a sort of paradox that on the one hand, medicine sort of races ahead, and there's a huge transformational technologies and innovations every year, it seems. And yet the delivery system that manages them or delivers the care tends to go slower. I don't actually accept, as Ian said, I think too rhetorically, starkly, that it never changes. I think you can point to some important things. For instance, how a general practice is clubbing together in various ways, hard and soft, all across the country, I think is an example of an actual change that's going on in business models. You might argue it has something to do with the fact that they're not fully publicly public bodies. But anyways, there are other business model changes like that. And I think it's too easy to just say no change has happened and all change happens in the private sector. Actually, we see great parts of the NHS doing making change happen, but not enough, not quickly enough, not widespread enough. Now, it is a supply side answer. I think we do need to do more as the NHS to innovate those specific delivery systems. So we started off with our Vanguard systems. Some of you may know about these. There's about 50 systems across the country. What we're trying to do is manage populations, try to reward those systems for managing populations, try to integrate services around the vulnerable groups and the older, frailer, likely to be hospitalized groups. We've had some good initial results from a number of them. Much better, lower hospitalization rates, in particular amongst older people. And so now the time has come to accelerate that further. And one of the things we'll do tomorrow in the Stevens plan, as opposed to, will be to, for instance, announce a number of systems across the country where we're moving to accountable care systems, is what we're calling them. And broadly, that means something like what we're doing in Greater Manchester, asking them to take much greater accountability for population health, for managing within their budgets in return for greater freedoms and flexibilities from the centre to give them more control, but also to locate the debate nearer where the need is. And I think we can see in several parts of the country a number of systems that are really ready to go and make big change on this around integrating services, integrating funding, beginning to horizontally integrate and work together between hospitals and vertically between hospitals and general practice in particular. I think we could be on the verge of a delivery system transformation. I do think we will need demand side pressures as well as supply, but we'll make a start from tomorrow. So I'll leave it there.
Thank you. The whole purpose of this conference is to look at business enabling that change. And I just wonder from the point of view of perhaps Four Seasons and also Arup, understanding the pressures on global healthcare and the complexities of different systems at different stages of evolution. How has the business evolved? How is business changing its mindset to work with different stakeholders, different vendors, different providers to deliver the care that is actually what's needed now, but also for the future. And I, you know, if that change hasn't taken place, then I'd be interested to hear that as well. But have you seen the business itself think differently about how it structures itself and delivers?
Do you want to start, Kelly?
I've got an example. I'm not totally sure if that's completely answering the question, but I think yes, we're, you know, in aid of being definitely being positive and coming up with good examples. I think this looking at new partnerships around new models of care, I think it's happening, and I think it is you know, despite what we've spoken about earlier about the rigidity of the system, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, I think it is happening. I think there are people who are exhibiting signs of systems leadership and you know, looking to make this happen. And an example that I'm, you know, personally involved in, and Arup has been supporting through, you know, a bit of free time, if you like, because we believe in it, is a project called the Defence National Rehabilitation Centre, which is replacing Headley Court. There's a replacing Headley Court in Surrey that's underway. It's construction just north of Loughborough for the MOD. But what we're working with the charitable sector to see if we can bring into being as a parallel NHS centre. And this is strongly championed and supported by the East Midlands Trauma Network out of Nottingham University Hospitals NHS Trust. So you've got people at that level wanting to, and I was just thinking about the talk earlier on about disruptive innovation. I think this is an example of disruptive innovation because it really is looking to do something in a new way to achieve a different result, which isn't just getting people safely home. It's getting people to the point where they can go back to work, which has a very important result for our economy. So we are seeing shoots and examples of how, you know, opportunities of how these new partnerships can come together. That said, we haven't got it off the ground yet, but I mean, it's an example of hope for the future, I think.
And you mentioned that the business is sort of letting you do it in your spare time.
Well, to a certain extent.
Sort of. Yeah. I mean, how open are they for you as leaders within the business to say, I'm really going to explore something that isn't in our core business offering?
Well, I think for us as a company, we have a slightly different structure in that we're wholly employee-owned, and that is all of the employees, not just a certain proportion of them. Obviously, we need to stay in business, and the better a margin we can make, the more we can reinvest. So some of it goes back to us, the rest we invest again. So some of that investment goes to things like this this initiative, which we, you know, feel strongly about.
Thank you, Ian.
Yeah, I mean, in general, though, I would make the point, I don't think it's really private and public. I think you can find lots of innovation in the public sector and lots of status quo in the private sector. You know, I've spent eight of my 40 years in management in the healthcare sector, but in the private part, so most of it in other industries. And frankly, change in any organization is really tough. And there is a status quo, and I think it's less so these days because regulation has made monopolies much less widespread, but it's very tough to change normal organisations, especially if they are close to monopolies. I started my business career with Shell, you know, and that was a real cartel, frankly, for about 20 years. There was no reason why Shell or Esso or the others should change. I think the problem here is monopolies, not public-private. And I think, you know, I mentioned competition as an important way going forward, and I know Michael and Simon and Matthew Swindells, you know, would probably agree with me on this. I think the challenge is, how do we introduce competition into the public sector? Actually, I think one of the mistakes that Tony Blair made, and I have to admit that I did work with him during that period and during his healthcare reforms, you know, he did try to use the private sector with the independent sector treatment centres as the sort of nut to crack it, and it was a real mistake because, you know, people just said this is people making profit out of it, and they put up the defences in the NHS. It was, in hindsight, it was a real mistake. As I say, at the time, I was all for it. In fact, Simon was one of the architects of it. So, you know, we all look back and, you know, we have to learn.
Was it really a mistake, though?
Yes, I think it was a big mistake.
Because
I think it
cut the waiting times.
And they've gone back out again, you know. So, I mean, it got repelled and we went back to normal, and the waiting times have have gone out again. I don't think we've seen any long term. So I think the issue is competition. It comes back to the things I said. I worked with Michael Porter for 10 years, actually, in one of the company and the strategy consulting firm. And I think Mike has got part of the answer here, which is information, outcomes. If you give that to people, they will act on that. The system will be developed. Actually, clinicians are, and especially doctors, are incredibly competitive. I mean, if there's one unit doing hip replacements better than the next one, and that's public data, they will respond bloody fast because they are hugely competitive. And they want to do the best by the patient. That's why they came into the place. So I think the challenge is, how do we create information upon which people can make choices, and clinicians and clinical teams can improve and create competition so that people are really responding to a customer need. Mike Porter's got a great example of transplant units in the United States where the worst had a one-year survival rate. The best had a one-year survival rate of 100% of this transplant unit, and the worst had a survival rate of 4%. If you give that information to patients, the people who pay for the system, of course they'll bloody discipline it. And the bad unit will either change or go out of business, and it should go out of business because it's getting people within a year. So I think the challenge is less public and private. I think it is much more about how do we create competition, visibility, and then come back. As I say, it's so irritating reading the Financial Times, even last week. Money is being siphoned off of the NHS to go into the private sector, to do elective surgery. That's not the way we should be thinking about it. As I say, who produces the best outcomes at the lowest cost to the taxpayer gets the business, and whether they're public, private, or, and I'm sure Michael,
Quite a part of how irritating that was. It was also factually wrong.
It was factually wrong, which
is even more irritating. And on the kind of waiting times, I think it's interesting that you say there's no lasting change involved. I mean, when you were working, there was 18 months people were waiting for operations. Now 9 in 10 people are doing 18 weeks. Look, it's getting worse, but that is a major difference, a lasting one, right?
But
I guess the question becomes, when is the tool of competition to be used, and in what form? What are you competing for? Is it for particular operations? Well, that feels like from an era where we had a lot of money and we had waiting lists of a certain kind. Now we're wondering whether we ought to be trying to create integrated care systems that might in turn, in time, learn to compete with each other.
And what about the consumer as a driver of competition? If you give them choice, if you give them access, are they surely not going to be the ones?
Well, people keep saying that, though. It's interesting in this country that despite many pushes, and you might say they were misjudged or they could have done them better, it is interesting that still people would rather go to a hospital closer to them than one further away.
That's completely wrong.
Well, then... Okay, so why do you think that demand side pressures haven't unleashed the?
And to support Michael, the Save My Local Hospital.
I shouldn't interfere at this point.
The Save My Local Hospital. I mean, what Michael is also saying, the Save My Local Hospital lobby is extremely strong. And it's.
But this is a really interesting point because this is where we want to go, don't we? Yeah. We want people to get into their heads that they'll get better treatment if they go to a specialist centre for all sorts of things.
I just want to make the point that have shown that clearly distance matters. This is a good to which you have to travel, to which your relatives might have to travel. But within that, we know that for a range of services, there's emerging evidence that patients also value clinical quality, or measures of clinical quality. So it is not true that people simply, I think it's very outdated to think that people simply choose on the basis of car parks, car parking fees, clearly, people make repeated decisions, and once you, reputation matters a lot in this game. But actually, most of the econometric studies of Britain show that at the margin, quality matters, and that includes work I've recently done on choice of GPs. Yeah.
Actually, inspired by Carol.
It's been the same group. We repeated her study using national representative surveys in Turkey over a period of 10 years after major reforms. And what we observe is something very interesting. So initially, utilization of primary care begins to increase because healthcare centers are near patients. Again, we're using econometric models. But what we see afterwards is primary care utilization continues to increase even though the patients are able to access hospitals, public or private, without any gatekeeping. And what happens is that we begin to see a decline in hospital utilization. But what we see, because we're able to use the survey data, a utilization of primary care increases because quality, perceived quality increases. So I think the behavior is a bit more sophisticated than what we are likely to believe. But there are not enough demand-side studies to really understand. But it's worth exploring. So distance is one factor, but there are many others. Users can be quite intelligent in the way they use the systems, but they need to be given the right kind of information.
That's really important information to help us make evidence-based decisions, yeah. Because at the moment, you know, the kind of orthodoxy we have from commissioners is about the local treatment, and that's really hard to get beyond that discussion.
Any other points from me? I'm conscious we've got about 2 or 3 minutes left, so any questions or points from the audience? You've got access to a microphone, and we'll get you one.
I was ultimately a surgeon. I worked in both the private sector, for the NHS patients, and in the NHS itself. I agree that lack of competition breeds complacency, for sure. But we also need to have a level playing field, because if you present patients into the private sector, they're very choosy about what kind of patients they will treat and what kind of patients they will send to the NHS. So the patients who are more complex and will cost more will end up in the NHS. So there does need to be competition, but there does need to be some consideration for developing a level playing field for that.
I just wanted to make a short point about closer to home and specialization, which is that although people might make individual rational choices about their own care, about whether they travel or not, when it comes to a general concept of closing an NHS facility down, yeah. Like Hammersmith, Charing Cross, A&E, for example, you get an almost insurmountable wall as a politician to do something rational. Yeah. So there's a category difference of decision, and both need taking account of.
Yeah, but I think on both of those, the Save My Local Hospital lobby is massive, and you know, they're dangerous people because they are killing people. I mean, it's the evidence from the hyperacute stroke units. So I think we do need to give people information. I think the clinicians need to stand up because they are, you know, God knows why, but they are still hugely respected in the in society. You know, and they will be listened to. The Aradazis, my brother Steve Smith, you know, they have incredible credibility, but they need to stand up and
just
say
those
that.
Two, yeah.
Just those two, yeah. All of them, I think, you know, they need to stand up and be counted. And at the end of the day, you know, I think if all of that doesn't work, frankly, we are killing people if we don't do this. And, you know, the leader does have to say we are going to do it. On a level playing field, but you know, back in the ISTCs, this was a risk-adjusted cohort of patients that were put out to the private sector at lower prices. I think the private, anybody would do it if you were paying more because there is more risk. But it definitely has to be a level playing field. Yeah. Sorry, Michael, would you?
I agree with all that.
Justin Watling, so in population health management. I was just going to pick up a bit. I'm not sure whether competition is the sort of sole answer to it, but I was going to reflect on the nuclear care model in Alaska, which is quite well studied. And actually, for them, it's about customer ownership, and they won't do anything without customer owners. Rather than a competition mechanism, actually, they put the citizens in control of the system and work very closely with them on the care model so that actually they were controlling really what was important or not. Yeah. So a very different angle that actually wasn't competition that solved it. It was a customer ownership model. And they have quite a nice graph, and I don't know how it's backed up by the evidence that's been mentioned earlier, but the plot, if I can draw it in the air, has at the sort of lower end of the sickness severity spectrum, the acuity, the customer ownership of the process is being very high, and the clinician ownership of how that care model should be very low, but actually, and that stays quite high until you get towards the very end when they flip over, and actually there comes a point when actually competition or citizen ownership doesn't really matter so much, they would argue, because maybe the patient's unconscious being right at the other end of the extreme, and clinicians need to work out what to do in that circumstance. I think it kind of reinforces very much that actually a lot of what can be done is around the citizen ownership of it, and I'm not quite sure that's necessarily the same thing as competition to solve.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely, and I'm not a American libertarian, you know, who believes in this Wild West. So don't get me wrong. I think commissioning is extremely important. We need a managed market. We need proper regulation and so on. And there are some activities, probably A&E, you know, which are not, you know, are not competitive and don't have the scale to be able to be competitive. But you need a regulatory system of which competition is a part of the things I said: information, choice, personal budget, commissioning. It's part of that total pie. It's certainly not. There is no silver bullet. It is how those five things operate together, and how you know. And the important point I do make, which you know, I feel we really, and hopefully it will be part of tomorrow, is that we focus on vulnerable patients. If there's one thing we could really do in a healthcare system that could begin to bring about reform, it is to move from the idea that the hospital, the unit, the care home, you know, domiciliary care is the unit of operation. And move from that and say, you are responsible for the patient outcomes of this cohort of people. You know, give me 100,000 people in Northwest London, tell me I'm responsible for getting them through to end of life in a dignified, you know, relatively pain-free way, managing their, working with them when they're living with dementia to give them the best outcome. If you think about it, it's a really radical change that from, you know, my career peaks when I'm a trust chief executive or chief executive of the NHS or whatever, to actually I'm responsible for managing a cohort of 100,000 frail elderly people in Northwest London.
I mean, that's exactly what's at the heart of population health and some of these accountable systems that we want to try to develop. And I think it gets back to your points about systems leadership, actually. This is the hard bit at the system level for us, is we've got a bunch of people that have been brought up running trusts, being GPs, being orthopedic, being surgeons. Well, we need to get some people involved that want to break down those barriers, move beyond traditional divides, and that's actually an incredibly rare skill.
So with that, I think I will draw to a conclusion. The one thing I would say is that I think we are making progress. I think, you know, the UK was put up today at the very beginning of the session as something that provides, that we should value because it provides universal healthcare, and it has value at its very core, and I think that is something that we are immensely proud of, and change is happening within that. But I think we also have to realise what we've learned about today in immense detail is this unbelievable wave of innovation. We are in a golden age of innovation, and that presents a very different pressure to the NHS. If the UK is at the heart of developing some of that innovation, the UK also has to be at the heart of adopting that innovation. And I think that is a whole new era of discussion, because what we're talking about here is delivering the foundations of care, but not necessarily delivering the next generation of personalised healthcare, which also has to be built into a system that is sustainable. So on that note, thank you very much. Thank you for joining me.